And on Central America, President Reagan vetoed legislation which tied military aid to El Salvador to its human rights record. The bill, which passed Congress unanimously, extended the human rights certification process that had been in effect for the last 2 years. This issue of military aid to the El Salvador government is a major issue whenever it comes up, and there are indications it will be even more so next time, because Reagan administration officials, including Undersecretary of Defense Fred E. Clay and others on this program, have said recently that much more aid is needed. The reason they cite is the increased areas of El Salvador now under control of leftist guerrillas fighting the U.S.-backed government troops. Several weeks ago, we had a report on the fighting as seen from the government side, specifically through the eyes and experience of an Army colonel. Tonight, we have a rare look from the other side, from behind guerrilla lines in the province of Morazon. The reporter is John Siceloff, who was there on special assignment for this program.
Bits and pieces of El Salvador have been in guerrilla hands for over 2 years. Rugged terrain for the most part, said by the Salvadorian government to lack economic and military importance. But reports from the battlefield indicate that situation is changing. In San Miguel province, leftist forces now claim to control all of the land visible from this mountaintop. Here and in other provinces, guerrillas have begun to patch together the areas under their control. Some spokesmen go so far as to say guerrillas hold 30 to 40% of the country. Guerrillas have put a priority on occupying towns as well as hilltops. In Potosí, only a few miles from government positions to the south, guerrillas turned up on market day to talk with villagers.
Viva la brigada, Rafael Arce Saula!
Viva!
Bueno. Viva el pueblo de Potosí!
Viva!
Viva la juventud valiente de Potosí!
Viva!
Potosí lies in the no man's land separating government and guerrilla forces. But behind the guerrilla lines exists a whole network of small towns under leftist control. Perquín in Morazon province was one of the first towns captured by guerrilla forces and has paid the price. In the past 2 years, government and guerrilla forces have fought over Perquín. It has changed hands 5 times. The fighting has destroyed many of the buildings and scattered most of the townspeople. The effects of the war are not as visible in nearby Carolina. Here, shops are open for business and the atmosphere is tranquil. Rebel soldiers in the central square are among the few reminders that a war is going on. The peaceful scene in Carolina notwithstanding, a guerrilla spokesman says it's too early to call towns like this part of a liberated zone.
Trabajamos con la población.
We work with the population, we stabilize production, and stay there in a permanent manner. That's logically when the army comes. We set up forms of combat where the army penetrates, and we set up sites here, because it is these territories that we know best. So I would say the best term for these areas is zones of control.
Still on the drawing board for towns under rebel control are the sweeping changes in land ownership and political participation promised by the guerrillas. Many of the town services in Carolina are provided by the very government the guerrillas are fighting. From government coffers come salaries for the teachers, for the post office, for the mayor's office. An official in the mayor's office explains the biggest difference, now the guerrillas are in control, is there is less repression.
Above all, there is more order within the population. And we are working, well, more freely. Because before the government security forces here, some of them drank, and always they were bothering the civil population.
For the most part, the guerrillas seem content to let things be in the towns they have taken over, putting most of their efforts into taking more territory. Each expansion of the zones of control helps towns behind guerrilla lines become more secure, provides more opportunities for recruitment into the guerrilla army, and makes the Salvadorian army's task more and more difficult. The guerrillas refuse to give a precise figure as to the size of their army, but knowledgeable observers estimate at any one time the left has between 5 and 10,000 people under arms. The fighters are young, some very young. Most of the guerrillas we met on this trip behind rebel lines came from rural areas. A surprisingly large number said they joined the rebel troops after family members had been killed by government security forces. Others said parents and relatives already in the guerrilla forces had encouraged them to join up. These fighters are undergoing a month's training at the military school set up by the guerrillas. The school is run by Mina Sandoval, a former captain in the Salvadorian army who nearly 3 years ago burned down his barracks and led 90 of his soldiers over to the side of the rebels. Sandoval's training features an eclectic mix of guerrilla tactics and conventional military techniques.
Avancen, avancen! Son in Dalecio, se pasó la línea de juego!
El siguiente equipo, avanzar! Not all the leftist soldiers got their training at Mina Sandoval's school. These two men started out in the Salvadorian army and received training in Honduras, courtesy of the U.S. government. They said they liked the training they got, but couldn't put up with the Salvadorian army.
Actually, what made me join the forces of the FMLN was that the treatment we received in the armed forces was not satisfactory. The treatment was very rough, with lots of threats against the soldiers by the officers.
Guerrillas say their major arms supplier is the Salvadorian army. Rebel raids and attacks, they say, have secured them everything from this mortar to boots and uniforms and, above all, rifles. The rebels deny the U.S. charge that Nicaragua and the Soviet bloc are major suppliers of arms. The overwhelming majority of arms observed being carried by the guerrillas were made in the United States. A guerrilla spokesman says the rebels now have the right ingredients, arms, troops, and high morale, needed to expand the war.
Obviously, the war is carrying us toward more strategic battles. We think that in the near future, there will be fighting in more important cities and in areas that are important geographically, that are important militarily, that are important economically.
But the leftist forces still have to face up to the fact that they have formidable opposition. There are 36,000 men in the government security forces. Government reconnaissance planes and bombers make daily passes over Morazon province. In mid-November, government troops began a sweep north into guerrilla-controlled areas of Morazon. Guerrilla troops were dispatched to strengthen rebel positions, and in this instance, the government forces were beaten back. Guerrillas admit they don't presently have the strength to win the four-year-old conflict. But from inside the zones of control, the message is upbeat. I'll see you in Plaza Libertad is a common farewell when guerrillas part company. Plaza Libertad is in the heart of the country's capital, San Salvador. This is John Siceloff in Morazon, El Salvador.